Good afternoon. Welcome to the International Webinar Series, Cornerstone of Scientific Publications, final episode, presented by Innovative Education and Scientific Research Foundation in collaboration with Innovative Publication. If you are having any difficulties regarding the audio and video of the webinar, then please let us know through the comment and question box. We will try to help it out. Please check your audio video settings before we start. Topic covered in this international webinar series, getting published fashion or need, strengthening the spine of research literature review by Dr. Ketki Pikalele, plagiarism and peer review by Dr. Lalit Gupta, how to write a scientific paper by Dr. Dinesh Kansal, type of manuscript by Dr. M. Hima Bendu, evaluation of research analysis from bibliometric to altmetric by Dr. Amina Sultan and Dr. Neetika Singh, reference manager software, know all about it by Dr. Lalit Gupta and Dr. Kedar Mehta. Today's topics are first course on scientific publication, but short course on scientific publication, and missive from editor to author, a heart-to-heart connection. Session comprises four sub-sessions. One is introduction, then presentation by key speakers, question answer session, and thanks for vote. I would like to start first introduction session from Innovative Education and Scientific Research Foundation, that is a non-profit organization and working with the goal to help researcher fraternity to disseminate their research globally by publishing in peer review journal, by presenting in conferences, research talks, seminar, webinar, etc. Our main vision is to promote scientific research globally and provide platform to community that tends to improve the visibility of work internationally. ISRF is an association of more than 3,000 members. For more information in details, please go through our website www.iasrf.org. In Innovative Publication is publication partner of ISRF, publishing in medical, dental, pharmacy, nursing, and allied sciences. Innovative publishes high quality peer review, open access articles in all specialties. Here are some reasons to publish with Innovative and experience the exceptional services. To more about the Innovative, please visit www.ipinnovative.com and submit your manuscript at www.innovpub.org. Our today's speaker, Dr. A.C.S. Jha, Director, Harishchandra Orthopedic Research Institute, Patna, Bihar, the patron and founder president, Indian Orthopedic Rheumatology Association. He is an editor-in-chief of COVID-19 journal, chief consultant, Bharat Vikas Sanjay Anand Hospital for Handicapped, Patna, vice secretary general, Asia-Pacific Society for Foot and Ankle Surgery, past president, Indian Foot and Ankle Society. Teaching experience have more than 30 years in medical colleges of Bihar, including Patna Medical College, India. Chairman of National PG Quiz Program in Indian Orthopedic Association 2003-2006. Dr. Ketki Kalele is BDS, MDS, and she is certified scientific writer and assistant professor, Department of Oral and Maxillofacial Pathology and Microbiology, VYS Dental College and Hospital, Amravati, Maharashtra. She is editor-in-chief, Journal of Oral Medicine, Oral Surgery, Oral Pathology, and Oral Radiology, director of 10th OPATH Specialty Oral Maxillofacial Oncopathology Research Center in Amravati. 20 international and national publication is indexed journal to her credit till date as her copyright research to her name. She authored two books. She is speaker in Cancer Conference, Spain and UAE. She is serves on reviewer and editorial board of various journals in of her specialty. And she is in National Advisory Board member of Innovative Education and Scientific Research Foundation. If you have any question, ask them in a question box in the bottom of your screen. We will try to answer as many unique questions. If somehow we could not answer your question due to time constraint, then we will be and email you the questions. You can email us at info@ipinnovative.com or editor irsr@gmail.com. Thank you. Now I would like to welcome request Dr. Ketki to join start with her presentation. Thank you.
Yeah, hello to all the research enthusiasts. My screen is visible and am I audible to everyone?
Yes, ma'am. You are audible, yeah. And your screen is visible.
Okay. Yeah. So, hello all. Very good evening. This is a wrap-up session today on the extensive series of webinars that have been organized by IESRF on all these months. So actually, today what was asked was, you know, that I should put all the glimpses of all research topics that have been covered in all the webinar series. I won't say it would be a brainstorming session or something, but it was a brain yoga, you know, wherein we have all activated our neurons in scientific research writing. But having said that, it's not possible to put everything in one single webinar today. So what I have tried to cover in today's course agenda is, you know, we will just go through very practical tips and tricks of making a research paper really impactful. Because, you know, today is not just the time of writing down your research paper and getting it published in a good journal, but it is all about popularizing your research, creating an impact, creating more citations to your research. To gain you more, edge indices and everything. So there is a multidimensional approach that we all need to follow today in the research writing. So we will just try to cover the practical aspects of it, especially on these three major genre of research paper writing, which includes original research, review cases, case reports. So let us begin. Well, I would like to say that, you know, scientific writing or communication, actually it is tagged as a very dry and very serious subject of writing, but it's not so. It's just like any other kind of communication. But the difference is that here a researcher is, explaining or communicating his research discoveries to the community. So it has to follow a particular format. Otherwise, it is just like, you know, telling a story. You need to tell story of your research, that how have the journey of your research started, how did you overcome the barriers, how did you reach the conclusion. Okay, so this is in a nutshell, it is a storytelling. And what special skills does the research writer or the author needs to have? He needs to be a very good narrator. He should develop good narration skills so that, you know, he can reach not only to broader audience, but he can actually reach to the heart of the audience. So in short, I have just tried to put an example of Disney characters. I always feel comparing it to very interesting aspects gives it all the more, impactful treat. So Walt Disney, he has created all his characters based on a lot of research, and he knew his characters really well. So that has made the characters immortal. Similarly, you as researchers also should be thorough with all the characters of your research. And this is the way in which you can really portray them well when you are writing down your paper. Okay. So having said that, I would like to just shed some light on various genres of scientific writing. Okay, it has become in the past and even now that writing a scientific paper is equal to writing an original article. Well, it is not so, you know. There are so many zones in which a scientific writer can explore his writing skills apart from writing an original research. So other zones, other genres of scientific writing, which are not unfortunately gaining that kind of limelight, includes, you know, writing good narrative reviews, writing short communications, case reports, etc. So for this, I have, you know, I would like to give an example or instance of a movie. Okay, say for example, research community is a movie, and original research is stands at the position of a hero. Okay, no doubt about it. It's the hero of the movie. But having said that, you know, there are other factors and other writing zones which have more importance than a hero. For example, systematic reviews or meta-analysis. These actually are the, you know, placed at the highest portion of the pyramid today when it comes to scientific writing. They act as directors, or you know, wherein they form a foundation on which many original researches can be based. Thirdly, I would like to say narrative reviews. They are like beautiful actresses or heroines in a movie. You know, you have to formulate your own narrative review. You have to really give it beautiful and interesting shades, the subheadings, the information laid down in that article, everything. So you can portray it really beautifully. That is why I thought of giving the name of a beautiful actress. And other than that, other than a hero, a director, and an heroine, there are many other interesting characters also in the movie. For example, the guest appearances, the comedians, etc. So case reports, short communication, letter to editors, they are all very interesting forms of scientific research writing. Okay. And I would like to say that it doesn't depend upon that how much is the length of your article. Otherwise, Watson and Crick wouldn't have got Nobel Prize for, you know, their DNA model, because it was in a form of a letter to editor, a 1.5-page article. So I think it all depends on how you have conducted the research and how you have presented the findings that makes the article really impactful. So let us begin now in our tour through this. First of all, we would like to start on you know, tips on writing an original research article. So as we all know, writing original research article, you know, we all know the drill. It has got a particular format which is known as IMRAD. That means it consists of introduction, methodology, results, and discussion. Okay. So this chart I have framed according to the length of every section. Okay. But having said that, although we know the ABCDs of manuscript writing or in original research and all, still there are many queries and much of confusion exists on, you know, what content should go where. Although we know introduction part is this and methods part is this and discussion is this, but what content should actually go, what that particular, you know, fill in the blank should be. So let us actually elaborate on those points today. Like, introduction consists of the content which is related to why the study was carried out. Okay, what made you carry that study? Because so much of literature is available on all the aspects. So what is unique with your study? How does it fill in the loop of it? Okay, so that is expected to be written in the introduction. Your research question should be there in the introduction part. Okay, so you know, tips in getting there is, you know, how will you go about, what will be your starting point? So starting point should always be some background on that topic. You know, in many research papers, you will find that introduction is named as background. So background is the one in which you will lay down some foundation on that particular topic. Otherwise, if you directly put that my hypothesis and my research question is this, it won't get connected. So always lay down some two or three introductory lines which are in general about that topic. Secondly, you have to emphasize that, you know, what is not known till date. And then you have to, you know, write down that how is your research filling the gap of what is unknown. What is your question and how is it going to answer the questions? Okay, what it is going to contribute in the research literature? Okay, so I just hope you all have downloaded the articles, you know, which were the link was being given by Nikita ma'am and the IESRF. So these are the articles which I had, you know, put for you all to have a hands-on experience, so that you all can read these articles with me and you and we together can understand more about every section of the research paper. So This article named Atypical Lymphocytes and Cellular Cannibalism, which was the phenomenon first discovered in chronic periapical lesions. Actually, these atypical lymphocytes and the phenomenon of cellular cannibalism, I have observed for the first time in dental cysts and granulomas. So this is my copyright research, and I just thought of putting the example of this. So here, in the introduction section, I have first, you know, I have divided the introduction section into three parts, wherein first I have given a general information about lymphocytes. Then I gave the information about atypical lymphocytes. Next paragraph deals with cellular cannibalism, that what actually is cellular cannibalism, that is a cell eating a cell. Okay. So I have told what is cellular cannibalism. Then I have told that where is this cellular cannibalism observed. So this is a general background about my parameters. And then what is my study doing? I have observed this cellular cannibalism and atypical lymphocytes in dental cysts and granulomas, which were not been observed before. Okay, these phenomenons were only observed in some malignancies or some very rare viral infections, and not in normal or common infections like dental cysts. So when I observed this under microscope, I thought of carrying out a research, and this is how my research journey began. My introduction should, you know, emphasize on these three points. Okay. Next, having said that, that you should divide your introduction likewise, having said that, now you know the basic things. Now, how to add spice to it, how to really make it impactful. So as I told you that, you know, you have to highlight the uniqueness of your research there, that, you know, nobody till date have observed this kind of phenomenon. Maybe there could be possible misdiagnosis, you know, because we don't know that such kind of phenomenon exists in benign lesions. They were only observed in the malignancy. So it could lead to major misdiagnosis of the lesion. So you have to emphasize on uniqueness and its clinical applicability. Okay, so that people will take up this research topic to read. What else you can do, what tricks can you make with this is, you know, you can, you know, make it a very, you know, what can I say, a non-technical terms can be used while writing introduction. For example, I have written, you know, like morphological aspects of lymphocytes in tissue sections are not routinely taken notice of, and they are taken for granted. So you can use such terminologies so that you can directly reach to people's heart. Okay. Explain your introduction as if you are explaining it to your colleague. That is the trick of the trade. Okay. Next section is the methodology section. Now, methodology is, you know, how it answers that how have you carried out your research. After why comes how. So it is basically the recipe of your research topic. Okay. So you actually, this methodology section is not, you know, it is not of interest to everyone. You have a targeted audience when it comes to methodology. Only those people will take up methodology who really wants to pursue some related research topics. So, so being an author, you have the responsibility to make it easier for, you know, people who are following your research, so that more and more research studies can be carried out. So what can you do is just chalk out some few important ingredients which in your recipe, just few important steps to be known. So how will you simplify it? Again, wherever there is some complication, go and divide things. It will create a more simplified matter, and you and the reader will be able to understand it clearly. For example, in methodology, you can divide the methodology section into context, sample collection and its criteria, and methods of analysis. Because these three things are the only things which are expected actually in methodology section. Context means that on what place was your study carried out, where was it carried out, you know, what all documentation were needed, what all approvals did you take, the ethical approval, the consent forms, everything. That documentation is very important for proving the genuinity of the study. So your methodology should, you know, include that. Secondly, it should, you know, include that how have you collected samples, how much is the sample size, what formula of sampling have you used, because more the sample size, better is the, you know, authenticity of the study. So you should have sample size in your methodology. along with the inclusion and the exclusion criteria, they're very, very ideal because they filter out the biases and every other thing. Okay. Third is, of course, the statistical methods of analysis, which you have to put in every research article. So again, I have taken an example from my article wherein, you know, I have divided my material and method section into three parts, context, then sample size, and then how have I carried out the study. So in my case, I would like to say that it was a microscopic study. So slides were my patients, or slides were my samples. And thereby, I have designed it accordingly, that poorly stained slides were excluded, or slides which showed remarkable inflammation were only considered because I was supposed to see the lymphocytes, isn't it? So that is why slides with maximum amount of inflammation were taken for. So I have designed it according to me. And this is what I mean by knowing your characters. You should know your characters, and then you can go and design and frame the study properly. Okay. Then comes results. Results is, what did your study show? It is actually the showcase of your observations. Okay. And by showcase, I literally mean showcase, you know, because you're just like you arrange or show, you know, show crockery in your kitchen. Similarly, you have to organize the findings of your research paper in the same way. You know, the most relevant and the most important observations should be portrayed clearly, and then it is followed by, you know, the lesser important ones. But in this, I would like to really tell you some not to do's and some to do's points, you know. Coming to not to do points, you know, just don't overuse of graphs and charts. You know, insert whenever it is mandatory or required to be inserted. Just don't make it ornamental in that sense, because it unnecessarily adds a complicated edge to your research paper. Okay, if it could be more simplified, you can just go and you know, have one or two graphs and then write sentences and don't give values again. Okay. Now, for example, you have given certain values in your charts. Your sentences shouldn't contain those values again and again. Okay, people can read the graphs. They can read the charts. Don't make it very lengthy. Okay, then I can tell you all that, you know, you should always possibly add, if you have certain other interesting observations along with your main objectives. Okay. For example, in my study, I have found that, you know, atypical lymphocytes and cellular cannibalism, I found that those cells were directly proportional to the amount of inflammation. Like, more the inflammation, more were they. So I thought that I should write it down. It is an additional observation. So go and do and highlight those, so that some additional information could also be conveyed to the readers. Okay. Now, how to do it, how to go about it. So, you know, for example, if you are conducting a demographic study wherein you are comparing age groups, okay, and a disease trait in those particular age groups, 20 to 40 and 40 to 60, and if you have to see a disease trend, you know, how much it affects these both age groups, and you find that no, there was no significant statistical significance of that disease among those age groups. So how will you write? You can just write that there was no significant difference between the age groups, and you can put a median age range rather than, you know, writing all this, you know, that the mean age group was 48.6 years and group 2 was 46.3 years. People don't like reading all that. You have already shown it in your graphs and tables. Simplify it and write in simple sentences. Okay. This is another illustration which I thought of putting, because I find this study very simple to read, and I thought of putting the example of it. You know, this was the analysis of lip print patterns in general Maharashtra population. It was a survey-based study. So, see, they have started results directly from the point that, you know, show the results of the above analysis showed that the most common pattern seen in the study was vertical type. So it's as simple as that. And they have not put these values anywhere in the chart. Okay. They have written it in sentences and they have not included it in chart. Whatever they have included in chart, they have not written point to point in their sentences. So this should be the approach while writing down results, is what I feel. Next, we come to discussion part. Discussion actually gives the maximum liberty to us as writers, okay? Like it actually, you know, answers to the questions are expected in this section, okay? For example, if you have written a research question in your introduction, then how have your study proved that research question is to be included in the discussion section, okay? So how to go about it? Again, I would like to say, give a brief of your study. Here you do not need to write down about general about the topic as we have done in introduction part, but you have to write a brief on your own study, that how was your study and what was actually your study, okay? Then you can start positioning the facts that you have received, okay? And you can start it, you know, with a simple sentence like the study showed, or the results of the study showed, or we found that. So such a kind of starting sentences gives, you know, a clear impact that now you are starting with your own results, okay? So basically it is decoding your results in a proper way. For example, in my in my paper, I have written that how were the, you know, results relevant. Then I have compared it to the other studies, which is again a very important aspect of discussion section. Whatever results you have obtained, you have to compare your results with the previous studies done. Okay. Previous studies, your results may be in accordance with the previous study, or they may be negative. Okay. So that doesn't matter. You have to put the facts as they are. Don't manipulate the results based on your hopes and expectations from this study, okay? They could be positive, they could be negative, but just, you need to portray them and present them properly to gain weightage on that study. That is, I think, the most important part when you are writing a discussion section. And ultimately, I would like to say that it is, writing an original research paper is just like, arranging a jigsaw puzzle. You know, you have to arrange each piece after one another in a systematic way so that you won't mess up, you won't leave any loop unanswered or, anything hollow. You have to have a concrete body, and then you have to lay it with very interesting information that you have gained out of it. So, as I told you, the tricks of the trade is, you have to always point, don't leave your research question unanswered. You have to provide answer for every objective, every parameter that you have chosen, okay? Then you have to, appeal straight to the point in the end. The end should always be very precise. Your conclusion portion should always summarize all the conclusions to the point. Here you cannot do beating around the bush, because the take-home message is very important when it comes to the end of the discussion, or what we say as conclusion, okay? And always, these are certain etiquettes of original research paper writing, that you should always mention limitation of your study, okay? Because no study is perfect, and people should know that what your study is lacking, so that next time if somebody picks up that topic, he can work upon that limitation and, have a better research. So these are certain, etiquettes that we must follow. Then coming to abstract. Now, abstract writing, I personally receive many queries on, how to write an abstract, basically, because it is of interest, because it creates the first impression of your research. And we all know that first impression is the last impression. So many a times when you submit article to any conferences or any journals, most of the time rejection is done based upon the abstract. So, you should really have a good abstract for your article. And having said that, abstracts are of two types: structured abstracts and unstructured abstracts. Okay. Coming to structured abstract, again, the names itself suggests structured abstract is having a structure. That means it is having a format, and you have to put in the findings and your data in that format itself. The format again consists of introduction, then methods, results, and then conclusions and implications. Your research paper may not have a separate conclusion, heading. The discussion may follow conclusion, but your abstracts needs to have conclusion. And along with conclusion, it needs to have implications. That is the applicability of your research study to the clinical field. Okay, so that is what is mean by implications. So how to go about it? So introduction, again, as I have told you, just lay down one or two lines on general about that topic and then come directly to what have your study done, what is your motto or research question. Then coming to methods, you need not write the complete method. You just have to go and mention the brief about the statistical test used and the sampling size, etc. Results also, just highlight the main and important results of your study. And then conclusion, as we all know, that two or three powerful take-home messages from the study. Okay. And golden rule for this abstract writing is follow publisher guidelines. Every journal has got different guidelines when it comes to abstract writing. Some journal prefers a 500 words abstract. Some journal prefer only 150 words abstract. So you need to have publisher guideline thorough when you are thinking of submitting that article to that particular journal. Okay. So coming to the next genre of our research writing, which is writing of review articles. For review articles, I would like to say that proper storytelling, is what connects with the review articles. I have put a grandma narrating stories to her grandchildren. Okay, so I think reviews are good narrations of all the research studies that have been done so far. Okay, and I would also like to say very boldly that writing scientific reviews is anytime more skillful and more difficult than writing an original research article, because original research article has got a format. Here you have to create your own format, and besides creating your own format, you have to go and do an extensive literature study. You have to collect so much of information. You have to mold those sentences into your own sentences. You have to actually cite the authors very well. Chances of plagiarism are the highest when it comes to review writing. So it is always more difficult when it comes to reviews than research articles, and it requires special skills, I guess. And we will discuss about it as we go through the slides. So scientific reviews are of two types: systematic reviews and narrative reviews. And as we have already spoken about how complicated writing review is, but there are certain advantages of writing review articles, as we all know, that they actually gain popularity very soon, more than original research articles. Because herein what you do, you actually do so much search on a particular topic that, you have assembled a lot of information that many researchers can, go and refer. Okay, so it applies to every strata of your audience, okay? Because a researcher will go and read your review because he wants to take up some study on the related topic. A clinician will go and read your review because he wants to know certain updates in management and disease course. Normal medical reader can come and read your review because he wants to know more about the disease and symptoms and prevention. So actually it is applicable for a broader audience, and that with that notion in mind, you should go and write your review. Okay. So how to approach, or what are the approaches of writing a review? So there are two approaches. First approach is, you come across some good topic and an idea strikes in your mind that, oh, this topic is not really explored. Then what you do, you go and do literature search, and then you come up with a gap that, this is known about the topic that is not known. So you can go and write on what is not known more. Okay. Or second approach is, you have done extensive research on a particular topic, for example, thesis. Okay, if you have taken some topic for your thesis, there are many other things which come out, while doing research study that, this parameter is also not explored. That one also needs explanation. So in that way, you can find the gap by your literature search, and then you can have an idea and go for writing research. Okay. So having said that, two types of reviews, as I have already mentioned, systematic reviews and meta-analysis. I have already given it the place of a director, which is the most important research projects, is what I feel. And it's not what I feel. Now even the PubMed and many university guidelines have changed their protocols and they have placed systematic reviews and meta-analysis at the topmost of the pyramid of the scientific research field. So why it is so? Because the systematic reviews and meta-analysis have got extensive review of literature with it. They have got so much of literature and so much of evidence with the kind of study they are doing that it is the most authentic or the genuine piece of work. Okay, so what exactly are the systematic reviews? Systematic review actually is study of studies. Okay, it is said to be study of studies. If you, for example, choose a topic of various treatment modalities for oral cancer, so the systematic review will contain all the available literature on different modalities of the cancer, all research papers, okay, all relevant, I mean indexed articles from indexed journal. So all relevant articles from good indexed journals, they are being searched, they are being reviewed, and then you make a master chart based on the findings that what author in what year have found which treatment modality the best. So this is your master chart. And then by statistically analyzing the results of all these study, you come to an outcome. And that outcome is known as meta-analysis. Okay. So it is actually systematic review is, I would like to say, it is a library on that particular topic. It acts as a whole library on that particular topic. So many a times in many journals, you will find that systematic reviews and meta-analysis, they are given the weightage of original research article and they follow this IMRAD pattern of original research article, okay, wherein your samples would be number of articles that you have collected and the place where you carried out will be PubMed and Google Scholars from where you have collected the data. And then your results would be, as I told you, the master chart of authors, their studies and their findings. So this is the most genuine and authentic form of research work that could be, that could happen in our scientific field. And I think more than that, more than just being authentic or genuine, the beauty of systematic reviews is that they are highly reproducible. It's very transparent. You just can't do anything manipulative in this, because along with our author and article, every data of that study is available on PubMed. You just have to go and click on the link and everything would be there on your screen. So it's the most reproducible form. Any author, if conducts review after 20 years or also on the same topic, will have same number of studies that were previously done and then updated studies that have been done after 20 years. So reproducibility is highest in this kind of research article. So for systematic reviews, I have taken the example of illustration from world's best journal, one of the best journal, Nature Perspectives. And I have again taken this cell in cell phenomenon by Stefano Fais. He has written this systematic review on this phenomenon, which is seen in cancer. Okay, so he has divided his review into various subheadings, as it is seen, mechanisms and interactions of those cells and actual what happens, to the cell. He has also given some good, neat and clean and high resolution images. This is all expected when you are writing reviews, okay, to make it more lucrative, more understandable, because otherwise it would be just like reading a newspaper. So you should actually give some good images, give charts, flow charts, figures, to make your data accessible and readable, okay? And this is his master chart, okay? This is his master chart wherein he has, cited all the authors, those who have seen this cell-in-cell phenomenon, not just in cancer, but in other lesions also. So we have cited all these authors and, I'm very glad that Nature Perspectives has taken notice of my copyright research wherein, Mines is the first and the only study who have found cell-in-cell phenomenon in dental cysts and granulomas. So I have got an appreciation letter from Nature Perspectives, and this is why I want to emphasize the importance of writing down your studies very properly, because in my article, if you go back and see, I have not done some heavy statistical analysis, etc. Neither my institution had provided me with any funding. But what actually made it unique was, you know, the kind of paper it was. I mean, the presentation of the findings and the uniqueness which I tried to narrate in my paper. So this is how is the systematic article framed. Now in this article, there are total of 136 references. Okay, so cell in cell phenomenon, how can it occur, or in how many lesions have already this phenomenon occurred, can be seen from these 136 references. You know everything about this phenomenon from a single article. So this is how systematic reviews are really helpful. You don't need to go and search for more references. Everything is available with one article. Next is narrative review. Now, as I have told you all, that narrative review is like a beautiful heroine. Okay, why is it beautiful heroine? Because it has got many features which are making it not only very interesting and worth reading, but also it is having unique information with itself. Because this is an article which you are writing, you are framing it, you are the director of this article. Because you know what information is not actually being spoken about on that particular topic. Okay, so it is having many shades along with detailing is what narrative review article is. Okay, so but having said that, review articles also needs to follow a basic format. You can add in your subheadings, you can add in your own observations, etc. But again, it is having a specified body to it, and on that body you have to paint whatever you want, more information you want to give. So structure includes firstly the introduction of that topic, then summary, that what all things have already been done and what people are saying already and what researchers have brought into light already on that topic. Then comes your own perspectives or your own review, what you want to say, what you want to add to it, and how is your review unique than whatever has already been discussed about it. And then again, any research topic is incomplete without its clinical applicability. Okay, so you should always, may it be your original research, may it be review, case report, even short communication, whatever you are choosing to write, always keep it in mind that you have to have some clinical relevance to your write-up. So in review, you should make a separate section on future prospects of that particular review, the clinical applications of it, so that it will make that article really relevant. Okay. And then comes conclusion, that what ultimately you wanted to say. So conclude it really properly and very precisely. Don't go for narration when you are concluding it, because sometimes people just go read your introduction and conclusion. Okay. So that they should have a clear-cut idea about what the review is. So this actually I have framed based upon whatever little experience I have in writing. So this many a times this acts as a roadmap for me while I sit and write down articles, that how to go and write review articles, because review articles are one in which you have lot of information with you and you have to place that information really and properly. Okay, so title or starts with the title of the review. Don't make the title of the review very lengthy, because people don't tend to read it so much. Okay, so it should be very neat. It should comprise of 8 to 15 words. Always incorporate the word review to it, so that people will immediately know that it is a review article. If it is a systematic review, you should write systematic review and meta-analysis, because your article will get great weightage when you submit it for publication. Okay. Then comes the abstract, in which you need to start that if it is non-structured, like we do for narrative reviews, start your abstract with words such as the present review provides or the review describes. Okay. Then you can go for a one-line introduction. As there is no methodology involved, you can directly go on, emphasizing that why have you taken up this review? What is your review adding? How is it important, etc. So just try to limit your abstract of review articles to 250 to 350 words, again, it depends upon the publisher guidelines, but by your side, you can have a brief abstract for review articles, okay? So, tricks in writing review, I would like to say that first of all, you should be like a swan when you are writing review articles. Why swan? Because swan has got that unique ability or capability to just choose milk and throw away water. So you should be like a swan who will just select a quality content from so much of excess data that is available today. So you should have that ability to select only the milk or the quality content and throw away what is not needed. Okay. Then you have to create your own story. As I have told you, you should be a great you should be great at narration. You should have full roadmap with you about how to begin, how to proceed and how to end. Okay. Then, now, because I have told you it is a very tedious job when you are especially going with systematic reviews, you know, you have 200 and 300 references at times. So it is really cumbersome affair for a single person to write down such reviews. So collaborate, connect with people, have connections with those who are working on similar fields. In this way, you can trade the information in a very good manner. Okay. And then I would like to say that start is the most important point. Just don't get overwhelmed with data overload. Write down, pen down whatever small things you want to start with. However your draft comes out doesn't matter, because that's the initial foundation. Then go on filtering your manuscript, go on adding the references, go on again proofreading. Proofread from your colleagues, have 2 to 3 opinions, and this is the way how you will come up with end product of the systematic review or narrative review. Okay. This article I have written, it is a narrative review on peripheral giant cell granuloma. It is a very commonly encountered dental lesion. Okay. But what is not common with that lesion is, you know, nobody knows why it recurs or what treatment actually it needs. Okay, everyone knows that, yes, of course, it's not a life-threatening condition and you can just, you know, have a small lump in your oral cavity, go on resecting whenever it recurs. But nobody knows why is it so. So as a student, this article I have written as a PG student. So I thought of writing down a review which emphasizes on the molecular aspects of PGCG, what goes wrong with the cells also, that why do they have propensity to recur? What the researchers before have said about it. So hence I took up this project, and as I told you, I have framed my own format wherein I have emphasized on the etiopathogenesis of this lesion, so that we will know that how can one prevent the occurrence of this lesion. Okay, I have framed flow charts to make it visible. Whatever points you need the front person to look or concentrate or focus, those points needs to be added in flowcharts or, diagrams or tables. Okay. Then this is the study which I wanted to, people to focus on. So I have written it in bullet points. Then again, as I told you, ultrastructural, immunohistochemical, all the molecular aspects I have tried to cover and put it in various chart formats so that people will directly have an access to the charts and they won't have to go and read back so many things that I have written. Okay. So this is the figure which I have drawn myself in paint and Microsoft Paint, and I have drawn this figure because we know only this type of giant cell and this type of giant cell. We don't know this type of giant cell. So hence I tried to incorporate this. It is again a unique finding which was not known. So as a PG student, I actually wrote this article in my second year PG, and I was not knowing about how to publish it in higher journals and all. So I just published it in my own university journal. And I actually got so many citations on this article, and 2 and 3 authors actually contacted me on my email that because of the unique information on this article, we had taken up research projects on it. So although not in index journals, still the article got so much of appreciation and citation. So this, I think, is the power of your writing skills. Okay. This article also had about 52 references. But what I would like to suggest, the mistake that I made in referencing this article is I have, taken research articles which were even before 10 years, which are not relevant today. So my key point or key trick which I would like to share today with you all is, you know, cite the references which are recent. Okay, recent 10-year studies you can cite. Don't go too long or too far, you know, because those findings may not be relevant today. Okay, then what should be done, that you should get your focus clear, that what is the topic on which you want to write and why are you writing it, what are you contributing by that, and you know, how will it make you know, its use to other community people. Okay, you should always have those noble thoughts when you are writing down review articles. Along with that, attractive subheadings, informational tables and charts, and as I told you, draw figures, draw with good legends. It always helps in getting noticed. Next section is writing down case reports. Case reports are something you know, which are basically nowadays they are not being considered very well by the journals. Okay, so one reason for that may be because so many case reports actually are coming daily for submissions, and they are just reports of your cases and not having any other additional thing added to it. So how when you know, when is your case report eligible for getting published? I would like to say your case should be really rare. It should be rare. Okay, by rare I mean it should not you know, be reported by many of the scientists so far. Okay, so apart from that, if you are not having a rare case, but if you are having a rare finding in that case, okay, then that is also worth publishing. Rare finding in a normal case, or if you have tried some new intervention to treat certain common cases which are working for you, even you can report that. So case reports consists of unique findings or unique cases, unique interventions, but unique thing is very important, okay, for getting your cases published. Secondly, whenever you are penning down your case reports, I think you should have a clear aim in your mind that your case report should be educational and informational, not just writing down what was the case, how have you treated it, on follow up patient was not having any lesion. So it's not your vahava, okay? Your case should contribute something that other people, that will help other clinicians or other researchers who will encounter similar cases in their practice, okay? So it should be educational, it should have clinical application, as I have told you, and some new updates to the already existing treatment modalities, or you know, already existing management protocol. It should really give some update to it so that it will be worth publishing also, and it would be worth citing and referring also. Okay, so this, so much of, you know, jungle of words is appearing right now on the slide, but you know, this is what a structure of a case report should be. This actually you know, it will help you all whenever you are writing the case report, basic headings under which you need to write. Again, I would like to say that your title of the case report should be very much clear. Okay, case shouldn't just be a case of oral squamous cell carcinoma. It won't get any weightage anywhere. If you are writing about, you know, some variant of oral squamous cell carcinoma, suppose basaloid variant of oral squamous cell carcinoma, a rare case, okay, so such should be your title, which will mention what is the uniqueness of your case. Okay, it should again not be more than 15 words. Don't try to make it very lengthy. Then your case should address chief complaint firstly. What was the complaint, or if you are dealing with some disease, why was the patient being admitted primarily, that everything you should have. You should have a detailed history of the patient, because through that only you have come to the diagnosis. So in case reports, all these factors are important. How have you taken history? What parameters have you assessed? How have you assessed the physical parameters? All those things are important when you are writing a case report. Okay, then past medical history, especially or family history, even especially you have to write down such histories which are going to make impact on your case presently. Okay, if it is just some hypertension or something which is you know, some eye problem or ear problem which has nothing to do with your case, you shouldn't mention it. Please try to have a concise information about past medical histories, and those histories which are relevant to your case should be mentioned. Okay, Then coming to the differential diagnosis or the provisional diagnosis, actually differential diagnosis section holds importance, at least according to me. I always emphasize on this section because, at first, just by looking at the patient or just by physically examining the patient, you cannot come to a direct final diagnosis. You need to have a differential set of diagnosis, what that lesion ideally could be. And if you write this differential diagnosis section in a real good way, that what all things have you considered before diagnosis and why your diagnosis is not anyone among your differential diagnosis. So if you write this down well, it also gives information regarding how to approach to the diagnosis, as well as your knowledge of the case also reflects in that. Okay. Coming to investigations, again, as it is a case report, I would like to say investigation portion also have got a good, good amount of importance, because here is the, diagrams or images, the histopathology that you have done, the radiology section, all the photographs and everything needs to be incorporated in investigation section. Many journals today, especially when it comes to histopathological cases, they ask for immunohistochemical diagnosis and more molecular diagnosis also, so that you that your editor and reviewer board will tell you also. Investigation section should be really good. You need to incorporate every possible key investigating factor that needs for the diagnosis of that study. So you should really design that well. Then comes management and treatment. So management and treatment also should have a protocol, that how have you begun, what was your design of the protocol, and how did you go about. If you're writing down a surgical procedure, try to incorporate images of those procedures, pre-operative and post-operative images of the patient. That would add on the genuinity aspect to your study, because case reports are very easy to snatch from each other, even colleagues can just snatch away your case and write down. So more amount of good quality images and relevant images makes your case reports genuine. Okay. Then coming to discussion part. Now, what has to be written in discussion of a case report? So first write down what have you find. You found out in this case, what is peculiar to your case. Then try to compare your case with similar types of cases that were reported previously. Now, as I have told you, that case report is a very unique thing. Okay, it's a very rare case reports are only being published. So there are not more than 10 cases reported many a time. So try and find out all those 10 articles and what authors have done when they have encountered those cases. So you can go and compare your case with theirs. So that will make your discussion section good. Okay. For example, if you are writing something on spindle cell carcinoma, go find out the articles which have reported spindle cell carcinomas. What have they found? How have they diagnosed it? Have they done immunohistochemistry? Then how have they managed it? Whether the patient is alive, or what was the survival rate in their cases, how they did the management part. So all these factors will make it again more interesting and more informative. Okay. And then of course the conclusion, that what have you ultimately concluded with that particular case. Okay. So this slide I have especially added because I know that case reports, again, when it comes to gaining weightage, they are not getting so much of weightage for publication. And case report is the most easiest publication that a person can have, especially clinicians, those who are not attached anywhere to academics or somewhere where they can really go for original studies. They can really find their publishing zone in case reports. So how to increase the impact of your case reports? I would like to say, go for case series. Case series is what it is, publishing two or more similar kind of cases. For example, if I have told you that I have tried, I have tried one kind of treatment with a particular case, so it would be a case report. If I took two, three similar cases and I have tried my unique intervention on all these three cases, and I found that no, the results are same. They are positive or negative, but you have tried your intervention on three cases. So it has got more weightage than a single case. Okay. Next is case report and review. So what you can do is you can write down a case report and have a brief review to it. As I have already explained, spindle cell carcinoma, if you write a case report and you write a short review of all the articles that have been published on spindle cell carcinoma, form a master chart as we saw in review article, that what authors in which year have found what with spindle, how have they design the diagnostic criteria, how have they gone for management. So if you frame this kind of master chart for say 10 studies of spindle cell carcinoma, it would get a very good weightage for publication. Okay. And thirdly, case reports with systematic review and meta-analysis, wherein you have to particularly go and search all the related literature on that particular case report. You have to collect that data, you have to go for analysis of that data and come out with a conclusion. So that is a case report and systematic analysis, which has got a very, very good weightage when it comes to publication of case report. So having said that, I would like to say that, you know, this was about the three important genres of research paper writing. And so I have penned, in the end, I have penned down certain general points which are applicable for any kind of research writing that you are taking up. For that, first come first, I would like to say that you, no matter how good is your study, no matter how original it is, how big budget it is, but if that story is having bad English and a lot of grammatical errors, it is not going to get accepted. And if it gets accepted in a way, it is not going to get further citations or anything. Because good English is the requisite of a good paper. And for that, you can go and hire technical editors also. You can go for author services also that are provided these days. Or you can simply exchange it with your colleagues and find out the grammatical and punctuation errors. So that is the best method for writing down a good research paper. Then, secondly, I would like to say no to plagiarism. Plagiarism is the worst thing that can that an author can do. And if your, you know, your plagiarism is above the accepted level, so you can even get you know, disqualified and blacklisted at times. So you have to you see to it that whatever you are whatever literature you are putting in your study should be cited well. Okay, in-text citation is what we say to it. You cite your whatever researcher or study you are picking up. Write it in your own sentences. Don't just copy paste things, and then you can minimize plagiarism by again revising your manuscript with the journal houses. Okay, then high resolution images with precise figure legends are important for impact. As I told you, again, whenever you're conducting a study or a case report, while conducting or even prior to conducting, keep it in mind that you need to publish it. So gather photographs, good quality photographs of the procedures, and you know, the resolution again is unique for every journal. Go through author guidelines and, you know, get it done, because good quality images gets priority for publication. Okay. Annexures, as I told you, especially in cases of original researches, documentation is extremely important. Again, in cases of, you know, case reports and all, confidentiality of the case, consent of the patient, all these are technicalities which one must follow, you know, to the point, because their major errors can come for you as well as the publication house and the editors. Okay, so keep your documents well. Tables and graphs in the paper should be properly mentioned. As I told you that, especially in result sections, don't go and write all the values. You can say it wasn't statistically significant, or this particular finding was noted the most. And besides that, you can just cite the table in which you have written it. Okay. So that, that is very, very well to be executed, because it is, it follows a sync when a person reads your article. Coming to this referencing style, I would like to, you know, I won't like to really dig much into it, but I just thought that it applies generally to all the research papers that you write. Nowadays, you can go for referencing softwares and EndNote softwares that are available, but not every person can do it. So basically, even I don't go for the software things. I also do my referencing manually. So manual referencing styles are of two types. Those are the Harvard referencing and the Vancouver referencing styles. These two styles are again specification of the journals in which you are going to publish your paper. So coming to Howard style, Howard style has got this particular format wherein you need to first write the author, the name of the author, you have to go for and write the year of publication, the article title in which you have to write the article in a sentence case, then you have to write journal title in capital, then volume, issue, page range. You also, here in Howard style, you also need to write the database name from where the article has been taken and the data viewed online. Well, this data viewed online is optional, but mostly this Howard style contains this. Whereas Vancouver style, which is most of the times in 95% of the journals we follow Vancouver style for research paper. So in that, first you have to go for writing down the reference number, then the author's name, author name, surname first, followed by initials in capital. Till three author, you have to follow this sequence. After three authors, you need to put et al, which means all others. Okay, then full stop, then you have to go and write the name of the article. And in that, you have to capitalize every word of it. Then you can write journal title, okay? Journal title, basically we capitalize only the first word and you need not have to go for complete title of the journal. The way it is cited in other references, the same way you can cite in short forms, okay? But in Howard style, whole journal name has to be written, okay? Then comes year of publication. After semicolon, you can go for writing volume number, then in brackets is the issue, and then with the colon, it is the page range. And after that is full stop. So this is how you have to frame your references. Your references should follow this style only. It is very particular for every article to follow this. So you all can, copy this out and just avoid confusion. Keep this in front of you whenever you are doing referencing, okay? So final take home messages or final key points, what I would like to tell you all is, referencing is really boring and it is very, very overwhelming for me because whole article we write down and then we need to know which sentence from where because you need to cite it. Okay. So what I do, I simplify it by, cite while you write. The in-text citation is what I mean to say, if I have taken a particular sentence from a particular article, I immediately write that sentence and then in the name in short of that article besides that. So finally, when you go and start with referencing, you can just see what article had appeared first, then what article had appeared second and third and like that. Okay. Secondly, don't be thankless. Don't do any kind of misery while, citing down authors and their references because it doesn't only add to authenticity of your research, but it also is, providing a tribute to people, those who have conducted research before you, okay? Also, after attending a crash course or a YouTube tutorial or something, the skill is not going to come overnight. You need a lot of practice of writing and a lot of patience is required when you take up a project for writing. Okay, so have that patience and practice and you will just start loving the researches and you will, you will take yourself in another zone. Okay, then finally, I would like to say, keep researching. People keep writing good research papers. They are the oxygen of the field now, and not only the field, even to us now. Okay. So thank you all for a lot of patience. Actually, everyone can write a research paper because you are so patient with me in all these slides. So everyone is full of patience here. Thanks a lot. Thank you, people.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. It's a very brainstorming session and covers almost all the aspect of scientific writing. There is a lot of pouring of messages here in a panel assignment for you. So just go through it and thank you for your presentation. Now I would like to request Dr. S.S. Jha, please give a suggestions to author for their publications on as an experienced editor you are. And now I'm sharing my screen with Dr. Jha's presentation. Sir, welcome.
Right, thank you. Well, I welcome all the dear fellow delegates who have been attending this session, and especially to Dr. Ketiki, who has been so clear in her expression. It
thank
was
you, sir.
Almost like a storytelling, as you have been emphasizing an article should be like.
Thank you, sir.
Well, Nikita, you have taken the lead for the cornerstone of scientific publication, and you deserve all praise for having so many sessions in Seriatim.
So kind of you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
And I once again send my greetings from Patna to all the offline and online persons present. Next one, please. Next one, Nikita. Yes. Now, the missive from editor to author is the title. What missive means, it is a kind of a directive or a message. But I very confidently feel that what Dr. Ketiki has tried to ingrain in the future authors, the power of writing skills, that will solve the problems of the author and of the reviewer and of the editor. Friends, there are expectations of the editor and reviewer from each author. Now, in my presentation, I am going to also tell you about the observations or reservations of the reviewer, which could be in a different direction. And also, I will like to answer, can the editor overrule to the best of his judgment? Next one, please. Well, I was just thinking of when must have the first editor come into the purview for the first writer. But whenever he came on the scene, you can say the editor became very authentic towards the author, and he had some, I might say, cruel directions to be followed. Next one. Well, what is the ultimate goal when you write a research paper or an article or whatever that Dr. Nikita has discussed? It has to pass through a process, and the final goal is that a paper gets accepted. Next one. Now, let me talk the whole issue into various headings, five headings. So the first heading is duties, obligations of editor, reviewer, and author. Next one. Well, editor, he is so hard pressed, has so many informations into his mind. Reviewers also always short of time, and author who have taken so much of pains to write an article. Next. Well, so the duties and obligations before acceptance are there for the author, reviewer, and editor. Now, author has to see, as Dr. Nikita has said, that they have to report standards, they have to have data access and retention in their articles. It must be original and very emphatically said. Plagiarism has to be not there or maybe minimum. The officially accepted is less than 25%. Multiple redundant and concurrent publications have also to be looked into. The sources that you have taken, they have to be acknowledged, and authorship of the paper becomes important. Well, coming to reviewer, he contributes or they contribute to editorial decision. they have to have promptness, whereas the editor has the right to make decision regarding acceptance of the article. There has to be a fair play. What is very common between the reviewer and the editor is the confidentiality, and there must be a disclosure of conflict of interest. Next one, please. Well, just talking about authorship, so each author should take the responsibility for a specific part of the work. And it is very ideal, rather more than an ideal situation, if you have a international collaboration of authors that authenticates the article to be multi-centric and is more likely to be accepted. Yes, next one. Now I will be talking about what is editorial process. Next. So editorial process is a process by which the content is finally created. The editorial process is iterative, and this iterative process is highly subjective. Now, what does this iteration mean? Well, you have to improve the design of the article by doing something again and again, and sometimes maybe only once. So this iteration becomes very important to come to the final redesigning of the content. This editorial process separates the content from simple data or information. And again, there is an important word, shepherding. So editorial process often consists of shepherding content through the content life cycle. I understand shepherding, everybody understand. Channelizing so many inputs into one objective aspect. Next one, please. Well, I would like to draw your attention to this photograph, where there is a dogmatic editor like person, and he says that for a fair selection, everybody has to take the same examination. So please climb that tree, whatever is the kind of the animal. And here Albert Einstein said, everybody is a genius. Now look at the pregnant sentence. But if you judge a fish by its ability to climb a tree, it will live its whole life believing that the fish has been stupid. So the editor should not be dogmatic and should have yardsticks different for different kind of articles. Next one, please. Well, why journal editors are so important? They are important and they have a crucial role in the publication process, and this each one of us understand. They are the single point of contact for the authors throughout the publication cycle. Authors rely on them. They represent everything that the journal stands for. Next one. Well, but there is a moot question, and the answer to that moot question is unfortunately no. And the questions are, do authors know exactly what the journal editors want? And do journal editors really understand the challenges authors face? So vice versa, the editors and the authors is claimed that they do not understand each other. Next one, please. Well, there was a study made, and there are four colors in this chart, and you can see the red one is under and incomplete. And look at the two aspects. One is the author side, another is the editor side. Authors say they are unclear and incomplete by 10% and the editor say 1%. Then unclear but complete, author say 34 and the editor says 11%. Clear but incomplete, author say 23% and editor say only 12%. And clear and complete, author say 32% and the editors are confident that they are always clear and complete in 72% of the instances. Next one, please. So let's look into the thought process between authors and editor. Authors think they understand publication ethics and do the best they can do to adhere to the standard guidelines. They address and respond carefully to all peer reviewer comments. Journal instructions for authors are often incomplete and unclear. Journal systems and processes are inefficient. At the same time, the editors, they think authors don't realize the importance of publication ethics. Authors only address the peer reviewer comments they find agreeable. Authors don't follow journal instructions well. And journal systems and processes are author friendly. Next one, please. So, editor here has an important role. He can bridge the gap. Yes, how he can do it? He will provide clear author guidelines. He will set up author-friendly journal process and he will have clarity in communication with the authors. And this will benefit both the authors and the editors. Next one, please. Well, the editorial process, this has to be understood by the authors that this is not a one-stroke go ahead for the editor in favor or against the author. It has six different stages. Stage one, pre-submission inquiry and pre-screening. Is the manuscript within the scope of the journal? Stage two, manuscript submission. There has to be identification of potential reviewer. Sometimes this finding or locating the reviewer becomes difficult. Peer review and revision. Well, I said there should be minimum two or three reviewers for one manuscript. And one may have to look for 7 to 8 reviewers to get their permission for finally getting the two or three. Acceptance of publication is stage four. Stage five, technical, copy editing, layout and proofreading, and stage six becomes the publication. Next one, please. Now, what is this pre-screening? In pre-screening, manuscript must fall within. Now, these are important. Here is the stage when even without review, the papers can get rejected. So, manuscript must fall within framework of journal guidelines, within journal's aim and scope, word limits, figure, tables, authorship, various criteria. They must be perfect. Plagiarism must be within limits and preferably not be there. Ensure retaining manuscripts with potential, lessening of chances for the manuscript to dwell unproductively in an unsuccessful cycle of review. Finally, likely to be published in the journal papers are to be sorted to be sent to the referee. Next one, please. Now, I shall be talking about what makes the peers quality. Next one. So, for the peer review, the backbone of the editorial process is peer review for any journal. Now, an evaluation process by which an expert critically analyzes the individual or the group seeking recognition, publication, or funding. Well, there has been a review in earlier sessions, and I specifically must mention that Dr. Lalit and Dr. Amina and even Dr. Nikita explained all about peer review and various processes in previous sessions. Anyone who have missed that feast of information, please go through the recorded sessions available on YouTube, Cornerstone of Scientific Publication. Next one, please. Well, editor's advice to reviewer also becomes very important, especially for those reviewers who are just into this art of reviewing. So, editor says, be critical in your analysis. They will read the abstract first, examine to find whether author's statement makes logical sense and has comprehensible manner of writing. Are observations made and reported in the manuscript really something new? Examine the table and figure to see whether legends are clear, and also the table and figure should demonstrate the same thing as is stated in the table and as emphasized by Dr. Nikita. Examine the statistical analysis, whether it makes sense. Next one. Examine the methods to make sure that the author knew what the reviewer were doing. Read the transactions and see if it makes sense. Does it reflect what in the data in the article reports? Look for unnecessary conjecture or unfounded conclusions that are not based on evidence presented. Is the manuscript concise and well organized? Next one. Well, there could be so many types of presentations for peer review. Journal articles could be there, conference proceedings, book manuscripts, grant proposals, teaching portfolios, promotion decisions, program accreditation, and even letter to the editor. So, methods of peer review could be a single-blinded or double-blinded. Single-blinded, authors don't know the identity of the reviewer. Double-blinded, both the author and the reviewer don't know either's identity. Double blind review provides honest review without the fear of retribution. Next one. Well, objectives of peer review are an essential part of publishing process, identifies the weakness and strength of ideas and approaches, validation and confirmation of a research work. They make recommendations like acceptance of the article, rejection of the article, or revision of the article, which could be a minor revision or a major revision. Now here, I must talk about the editor's dilemma. Well, if there are two or three reviewers, they may be contradictory to each other. They could, in good sense, entirely misinterpret the whole article. So here comes the role of the editor. He can appoint another reviewer, or you can call it an arbitrator, and then the editor will come to his own conclusions. Next one. I will now be discussing about the fourth headline, what reviewers and editors are really looking for. Next one. So the journal reviewer looks for importance and broad interest of the subject, quality of the data, novelty and importance of the work described, extent of the data support and the conclusions made, completeness of the citations, clarity of the writing, appropriateness of the work for that particular journal. Next. Now, what the editor is looking for a wow factor. a subject or theme that sheds light or gives insight. Again, novelty and clarity are indispensable. Value of practical research and its theoretical implications are also very significant. Manuscript is written clearly and in correct format, and if it fits within the scope of the journal. Next one. Well, look into this. Here is an editor who makes a sarcastic comment. Oh, it was a great read, except with run-on sentences, tripped over broken English, and got knocked about by a dangling participle. So friends, be aware, good grammar, good English is a must. How will authors benefit? Well, having easy access to all essential information will increase authors' confidence during the journal submission. Authors will prepare a better submission package that will adhere to all journal guidelines. Authors will know what is expected from them, and they will follow the best publication practice. There will be lesser chances of authors misunderstanding their editors. Next one, please. Well, quality of submission will improve. So this will be the advantage to the editor. Cleaner journal process will help them to reduce clutter. We are into Diwali days. And so reduction of clutter and smoother submission cycle becomes important. Offline communication with authors will definitely reduce. And by encouraging authors to follow best publication practice, editors will be seen by the authors as advisors and thought-provoking leaders. This is so very important. Yes. Next. So reviewers' comment could be in one or two of these expressions. Lack of clarity in writing. Logic of argument is unclear. Author is unaware of relevant existing work. Author misinterprets existing research. Data is not convincing. Contribution to the research is not apparent. Next one. Now, in spite of all this, there are some problems which keep on appear frequently. So, dear authors, try to see that these problems do not take place. Submission of the paper, which are clearly out of scope for the journal. Failure to format the paper according to the style. Inappropriate or no mention of suggested reviews. Inadequate response to the reviewers. Inadequate standard of English cannot be more overemphasized. Resubmission of the rejected manuscript without revision is almost a crime. Next one. Now I will be coming to the conclusion part, and that is missive for acceptance. And this is the final advice from editor to the author. Few more slides. Next one. Well, why it is important to write a good article or a paper? Before submitting an article, make sure it is as good as you can make it. Not only because it makes your life easy, but also the lives of the editors and the reviewers. And your chance of acceptance will be increased. Next one. Again and again, check your English, both grammar and construction. Pay attention to the ethical standards. And these ethical standards have been highlighted by Dr. Nikita. Get the article proof read by your colleagues, and not one, maybe two or three colleagues. And always remain self-critical. Next one. Now, attention to the details are very important. Check and double check your work. Friends, it is aptly said that you write your research paper, keep it in a drawer, forget it for about 2 weeks, and it is only after 2 weeks you take it out and with a fresh mind again look into the paper, you will yourself make many improvements in the article. So that becomes the double checking. Consider reviewer's comment. Whenever you receive a comment from the reviewer, you are obliged to obey it and do it accordingly. English again and again must be as good as possible. Your presentation is very important, and definitely take your time with revisions. Next one, please. Acknowledge those who have helped you. Gold standard, I have coined this word, gold standard. What are the gold standard paper? As already said, that the letter to the editor was just half page article. So a concise article, a direct article is the gold standard. Even new, original, and previously unpublished articles are also gold standard. Critically evaluate your own manuscript. Ethical rules must be obeyed. I have knowingly repeated English, ethics, etc. Next one, please. Sometimes papers are simply sent to the wrong journal, and that is becoming increasingly the case, and these papers do not get published. So, friends, before sending the paper, you must adhere to the guidelines. Some journals don't want to publish them because they were not good papers, but because they were sent to a wrong journal. And clarity in explanation is a must. Next one, please. Well, editors, in spite of all the missives that I have said, are also human beings. So editors are conscious of maintaining reputation of their journal to be top journals. And hence, they are always, not only, but always looking for top articles. Friends, if you remember, you are appearing in a Viva Voce examination, we say, a good examinee is one who leads the examiner. So likewise, a good author should stimulate both the editor and the reviewer. Such should be your writing style. Friends, title of the presentation, title of the, abstract and conclusions. These three things are invariably the only parts visited by the editor and sometimes also the reviewer. Hence, give proper attention when you are writing title, abstract, and conclusion. Reviewers, like, they are also like any other person, but they are also running short of time every day, and they have a desire to favor only the ideal article, but daily routine keeps him busy, and so there could be a delay. When we are talking of delay, the ideal time provided to a reviewer is 2 weeks, but editors always feel it could be double the time, maybe 4 weeks. Next one, please. Be honest with yourself. And so I say, hurry spoils the curry. Article should have a message. This is very important, but do not feed so many messages at the same time in the same paper. So you must restrict your messages to not more than three. And again, title is so important. Use proper structure to promote the article. This encourages citation too. Enjoy waiting. Friends, I again say, enjoy waiting, because good news takes time, whereas bad news is quick, and quicker decisions are likely to be negative. Just to tell you in the end, that why you should wait longer, because post submission paraphernalia, quality of the content evaluation, impact factor, and verification of author supplied references, they have to travel on so many tables, and so they take time. So friends, I will like you to be in the habit of waiting. Next one, please. Friends, thank you very much, because you had very good attention, but God forbid you may not get this kind of a dogmatic, this kind of a editor who says he has written this book, but he has not even read it once. Next. Thanks again. God forbid, you must not be like this and do not rely on the mercy of the editor. You should be different. Dr. Kethi has given you so many directives to say that how you will write, and the editor has to accept it for publication. Please wait, friends, because next one, because I have said it is always good to wait. So the long wait of the author, intezar, wo na aayega hame maloom tha is sham bhi, intezar uska magar kuch soch kar karte rahe. Again further, kin lafzon mein likhu main apne intezar ko tumhe, bejua hai isk mera dhoondta hai khamoshi se tujhe. And finally, उल्फत के मारों से ना पूछो आलम इंतजार का, पतझर सी है जिंदगी और ख्याल है बहार का. फ्रेंड्स, डियर ऑथर्स, योर रिसर्च पेपर इज लाइकली टू बी एक्सेप्टेड. प्लीज वेट. थैंक यू. थैंक यू.